My name is Akansha Nehra. I am a certified soft skill trainer and currently associated with Koenig Solutions. And we are renowned for providing comprehensive training in both IT and non-IT sector worldwide from last 30 years. So today, our focus is on an indispensable aspect of effective leadership, means emotional intelligence, the how we interconnect the leadership with the emotional intelligence. And we will delve into why leadership through emotional intelligence is paramount, like its significance in today's dynamic business landscape, and practical strategies to apply EI, the emotional intelligence, in leadership role. So for that, let's first understand and first justify what it is all about. Is that true that leadership is about inspiring trust? It means you have the question and we have the chat box and you can write it down over there. And at the end of the session, we will discuss. If you have any question in between the session, you can write it down in the chat box. And after the session, we will definitely discuss your questions and answer. So leadership is inherently intertwined with the notion of trust, as it serves as the cornerstone upon which effective leadership is built. So trust is the bedrock of any successful relationship, right? See, whether it is between a leader and their team members or among colleagues within an organization. A leader who inspires trust fosters an environment, right, where individuals feel safe and individuals feel valued and respected. So when team members trust their leader, they are most likely to openly communicate, openly collaborate, and share ideas. And knowing that their contributions are valued and respected. So trust in leadership also cultivates loyalty and commitment, as team members feel confident in their leader's ability, why? To lead them towards shared goals and navigate challenges effectively. Moreover, trust enables leaders to delegate the task with confidence and knowing that their team members will execute them with diligence and integrity. Ultimately, leadership that inspires trust, not only enhancing team morale, or you can say also drive organizational success by fostering a culture of transparency, accountability, and mutual respect. Emotional intelligence, people, play a very important role. Why? In enhancing leadership effectiveness. So by significantly improving the communication, conflict resolution, and decision-making within the organization, what we are supposed to do? The answer of this question. To begin with, leaders with high IQ or high emotional intelligence possesses the ability to communicate effectively, as they understand the nuance of, you can say, verbal and non-verbal cues, enabling them to convey their messages clearly and empathetically, thereby fostering trust and you can say, rapport among team members. After that, IQ and EQ, both, means leaders with the skill to navigate conflicts constructively by understanding emotions and perspective of the third party involved, facilitating empathetic learning, listening, and finding mutual benefit solutions, ultimately fostering a good relationship, a harmonious relationship, work environment conducive to productivity will enhance their work accordingly. That's why in leadership, that trust and emotional intelligence, understanding the emotions of others as well as your emotions while talking, while communicating, while thinking is very important. So what will be the learning objective of today's session? By the end of this presentation, you will understand the concept of leadership and its characteristics, why it is important, its significance, and its components. The leadership style, autocratic, democratic, right? And you can say servant leadership, then leadership models, and emotional intelligence at last. So what is leadership actually? Is it the process whereby an individual influences a group of individuals to achieve a common goal? Leadership is about the relationship between the leader and the people around him and her. So additionally, emotional intelligence empowers leaders to make sound decisions. by effectively managing their own emotions, staying objective, and considering the impact of their choice on others, leading to more thoughtful and inclusive decision-making processes that align with the organization goals and values. Thus, by leveraging emotional intelligence, leaders can create a culture of open communication, collaboration, resilience, and driving overall organizational success. But by applying emotional intelligence in leadership, what will you get? You will encourage the leaders to reflect on their emotions, strength, weakness, and their impact on others. While practicing such as journaling and mindfulness, it will help you can aid in self-awareness. You will aware about yourself, your thoughts, your ideas, how you deliver your decision, how you delegate the work. Emphasize the importance of managing one's emotions effectively and staying composed under pressure and avoiding impulsive decision that may harm team dynamic. Now then, what we have to do, we have to guide leaders to actively listen to their team members, actively listening to everyone and understand their perspective. Consider their perspective and your point of view and demonstrate empathy by acknowledging the feelings and concern. We need to highlight few points. We need to highlight the significance of strong interpersonal skills, such as effective communication, conflict resolutions, and building network. At fostering a positive team and environment, how? When you inspire leaders to set meaningful goals, providing recognition and rewards, and cultivate a sense of purpose and passion within their team. But what are the most common characteristics in this? First is caring, approachable. You should look like that people can come to you, they can talk to you, they can share their ideas, their thoughts, and you must have that transparency. Has integrity, bring out the best in people, positive, supportive person, accept the challenges, take the risk, be respectful, affirming the positive things, understand each other, enthusiastic, you need to be thoughtful, sense of humor, inspiring, has a vision, and accept the people. The true nature of leadership. First is personal leadership style. So the specific way, we have a specific way in which a manager chooses to influence others, shape the way that managers approach the other principal task of management. So the challenges is for managers at all levels to develop an effective personal management style. The personal leadership style, we have autocratic style of leadership, means a leader who centralizes authority, dictates work methods, make unilateral decisions, and limit employee participation. Then next we have democratic style of leadership, means a leader who involves the employee in decision making, delegates authority accordingly, encourage participants, all the team members, in decision making, deciding work methods and goal, and uses feedback to coach employees. A democratic consultative leader seeks input and hears the concern and issues of employee but makes the final decision him or herself. A democratic participant leader often allows employee to have a say in what's decided, what resonate and what does resonate. First is visionary, which is resonate, coaching, and democratic. Then resonate means you are commanding. You are showing that, yes, you are the boss and you are not listening to anyone. It is. What is the conclusion? What is that leadership through emotional intelligence is not just a desirable trait, but necessary in today's fact, means a today's fast paced or interconnected business environment. So by honing the EI skills, leaders can effectively navigate the challenges, right? Inspiring their teams and drive organizational success while fostering a culture of trust and collaboration and innovation. The next part is the nature of leadership. Means we will now distinguish between the managers and the leaders. Only then we get to know how a manager looks like and sounds like. Managers establish and implement procedures to ensure smooth functioning, whereas leaders look to the future and chart the course of the organization. Leadership across cultures. Leadership styles may vary among different countries or culture, right? Like European managers tend to be more people-oriented than American and Japanese manager. Japanese managers are group-oriented, while US managers focus more on profitability. Source of managerial power, the different legitimate, coercive, reward, and export. The power, legitimate, we have, means the authority that a manager has by virtue of his or her position in the firm. Then we have reward power, the ability of a manager to give or withhold tangible and intangible rewards. Effective managers use reward power to signal to employees that they are doing a great job. Then corrective power means the ability of a manager to punish others. For example, verbal reprimand or pay or cuts, right? And limit to effectiveness in applications, which can have serious negative side effects. But what is the export power? That is based on special knowledge, skills, or expertise that the leader possesses. Tends to be used in guiding or coaching manners. Then power, the key of leadership. Referent power, that is power that comes from subordinates and co-workers, respect, administrations, or loyalty possessed by managers or who are likable and who subordinates wish to use in a means to use as a role model. It is the ability, the emotional intelligence, while understanding this thing, it is the ability to recognize, to understand, to manage, to express the emotions effectively both in oneself and in others. So we need to discuss few things in this, that is your self-awareness, which we will discuss, self-regulation, empathy, social skills, and motivations. So we have the four quadrants in this. The first is, you can say, self-awareness. After self-awareness, then you need to build yourself, right? Self-building or self-regulation. When you understand yourself clearly, then you will jump to the third part, social awareness. Now you're understanding people, their behavior, how they respond or how they react. Once you understand people management or social behavior or social awareness, then last will be, you will try to build a strong relationship with others, right? So that you can have win-win situation from both the side. And that quadrant is known as relationship management, which is focused on the process of management, that is planning, organizing, how you behave, how you implement each and everything, how you delegate work, how transparent you are, how are you listening to your people, and highlight all the significance of all the emotional intelligence process, all the interpersonal skills such as effective communication, and how you resolve the conflicts, how you build the network, rather than just saying to your people, we need to resolve the conflict, we need to build network. You are eventually doing it practically. You are setting up the example, rather than just telling your team members that we are family, we are one team. We need to take action towards that too, not just inspiring by the words. Empowerment means an ingredient in modern management. So the process of giving employees at all level in the organization means the authority to make decisions. We need to be responsible for their outcome, improve quality, and cut cost. So empowerment increase a manager's ability to get things done. Empowerment increase workers' involvement, motivation, and commitment. Empowerment gives manager more time to concentrate on their pressing concern. Leadership models we have. First is trait model. You need to attempt to identify personal characteristic that causes for effective leadership. And research shows that certain personal characteristics do appear to be connected to effective leadership, and many traits are the result of skills and knowledge, and effective leaders do not necessarily possess all of these traits. Behavior model. Now we need to identify the two basic types of behavior that many leaders engaged into influence their subordinates. Consideration means leaders show subordinates their trust, respect, and care about them. Managers look out for the well-being of their subordinates and do what they can to help subordinates feel good, enjoy the work they perform. Initiating structure. Leaders take steps to make sure that work gets done. Subordinates perform their work acceptably, and the organization is effective and efficient. Managers assign tasks to groups and let subordinates know what is expected to them. Then contingency models of leadership. Means what make a leader and means sorry, what make a manager an effective leader is one situation, not necessarily what that manager need to be equally effective in other situation. Means whether or not a manager is an effective leader is the result of their interplay between what the manager is like and what he does and the situation in which leadership takes place. Fedler models. We can also pronounce it as Fedler. Fedler. Means effective leaders is contingent on both the characteristics of the leader and the situation. Relationship oriented we have and task oriented. Relationship oriented means leader concerned with developing good relations with their subordinates and to be liked by them. Task oriented means whose primary concern is to ensure that subordinates perform at a high level so the job gets done. Situation characteristics. Now leaders member relationship extended to which followers like trust and are loyal to their leaders. Trust. Then next is task structure, means extent to which the work is performed is clear cut so that a leader's subordinates know what needs to be accomplished and how to go about doing it. Position power, the amount of legitimate reward and coercive power leaders have due to their position. When positional power is strong, leadership opportunity becomes more favorable. Transactional versus transformational leadership behavior. Transactional means use the reward and coercive power to encourage high performance. They exchange rewards and performance and punish failure. Now push subordinates to change, but do not seem to change themselves. Transformational is totally different. Leadership that makes subordinates aware of the importance of their job or at the organization, for the organization, and how necessary is for them to perform those jobs as best they can so that the organization can attain its goal. The next part, let's study about in detail what is emotional intelligence, which is an array of capability, competencies, and skill that influence one's ability to succeed in coping with environment demands and pressure. It means you're understanding your emotions as well as others' emotions. And it is a factor in determining one's ability to succeed in life. Relates to potential for performance. And we are being judged by new yardstick by Daniel Goleman. Not just how smart we are or by our training and expertise, but also how we will handle ourselves and each other. How does EQ differ from IQ? EQ focus on developing an understanding of and the ability to manage emotions. EQ can develop and enhance through life. And until recent years, EQ has been overlooked in predicting a person's potential for success, whereas IQ focus on developing cognitive abilities and is more academically oriented. IQ is thought to be established at birth and cannot be enhanced. And IQ has traditionally been used to predict a person's potential for success. Now the four quadrants which we were talking about, the self-awareness, management, social awareness, and relationship management. Self-awareness consists of emotional self-awareness, accurate self-assessment, and self-confidence. The next is self-management. When I'm aware about me, I know where I have to work. Self-control, transparency, adaptability, achievement, initiative, and optimism. Social awareness. Now, if I am working on myself, I will need people in my life. Why? To guide me somewhere, to help me in my business, or to be in touch with me emotionally and to understand things. Or I need to be available for them too.
Then we need empathy to understand people, the emotions, the courtesy, the politeness while talking, organizational awareness, and service we provide, or service I provide to others. Then relationship management, influence, inspiration leadership, developing others, change catalyst, conflict management, teamwork, and collaboration. EQ and leadership. The moods of leaders, these groups whose leader experience positive moods had better coordinations, and groups whose leader experienced negative moods exerted more efforts. Emotional intelligence in this helps leader develop a vision for their firm, helps motivate subordinates to commit to their visions, and energize subordinate to work to achieve the visions. Thank you so much for time and patience, everyone. Now, what we have the chat box, and we are open to question and answer round. You can ask me any question related to this program, related to this session of today, and I will answer you definitely. And to answer the question, just allow me a few seconds. You can ask any question in the chat box, please. Yes, we will definitely share you the recordings. You can ask as many questions as you can. Anyone, do we have any question? Okay, so we have a question over here. How come some people have a flair and are able to easily mix around and few others struggle to do the same? So the ability to effortlessly socialize, right, and mingle with others, often referred to as having a flair for social interaction, right, and can be attributed to a combination of factors, including the personality traits, social skills, past experience, and environmental influences. See, in this, some individuals naturally possess personality traits, right, that facilitate social interactions such as extroversion, warmth, openness, and empathy. And these traits make it easy for them to initiate conversation and express themselves comfortably and connect with others on an emotional level, right? If we talk about, see, first was the personality trait. Second was social trait. I'll discuss that. Is in this, effective social skills such as active listening, communication skills, and non-verbal communication, the body language, the facial expression, all these play very vital part in interpersonal interactions. Individuals who have won these skills through practice or upbringing often find it easier to navigate social situations, right, and establish rapport with others. On the other hand, see, we have few in this personality traits, social skills, past experience. We can talk about it, environmental influences. On the other hand, individuals who struggle with socializing may have different combination of personality trait, social skill, deficit, past experience. Means, example, negative social encounters or social anxiety or environmental factors. Means lack of social support and cultural barriers that hinder their ability to connect with other effectively. And it is essential to recognize that socializing is a skill that can be developed and improved over time with practice, self-awareness, and sometimes professional guidance. Additionally, if we embrace one's unique strength and find comforting and genuine connection rather than conforming to societal expectation, can also contribute to more fulfilling social interaction. Okay, we have a bunch of questions over here. Thank you so much, everyone. Okay, so next question we have, let me combine two questions and let me turn off my camera because my camera is not working today. I'm so sorry for this. Okay, so the two questions we have, let me combine two questions like, how can one overcome emotions to superior as well? And one from Samson, that is, recommendable to work for the manager who is emotionally exhausted? Overcoming emotions with superiors. See, when interacting with superiors, it's very important to manage a professional demeanor while effectively managing emotions. We can talk about few strategies means to overcome emotions when dealing with superiors. First is emotional awareness, self-awareness means recognizing your emotional triggers and understand how they may influence your behavior and communication. Emotional regulation, we need to practice techniques such as deep breathing, mindfulness, and taking a moment to pause before responding. Because if we are not just thinking, we are reacting, we are not responding. So we need to sometimes listen to the conclusion before reacting in the middle to answer. Because sometimes we feel like we are not responding. We are waiting for the person to stop to answer that. And when we are doing it, we are not listening to that person. So we need to respond to control emotional reaction. Instead of dwelling on emotion, focusing on addressing the issue at hand and finding constructive solution. And if appropriate, we can consider discussions, concern or emotional challenges with your superior in a professional and respectful manner and emphasizing a desire to work collaboratively towards a regulation. Now, the first was that working for an emotionally exhausted manager. That is, working for a manager who is emotionally exhausted can present challenge, but it's important to approach the situation with empathy and professionalism. Means obviously, we need to respect that person's boundary and be meaningful and be mindful of their workload and emotional state. If feasible, offer assistance with task or responsibility to elevate some of your manager's burden. Ultimately, if you navigate relationship with superior and working under challenging circumstances, it requires a combination of both emotional intelligence, effective communication, and a proactive approach to problem solving. And if the situation persists and significantly impacts your work environment, consider discussing potential solution with HR or high-level management while maintaining professionalism and confidentiality while talking or while discussing any kind of email. Okay, one more question we have. That is, okay, let me combine a few more questions over here so that I can answer quickly. And is it possible to have emotional intelligence in your work life but not in your personal life? And what caused that? All right. Then Mr. Balaji asked, do you suggest any author or book to improve EQ? All right. See, emotional intelligence, discrepancy between work and personal life. Yes, it is possible to demonstrate emotional intelligence in one's work life while struggling to apply it in personal life. And this phenomenon can stem from various factors, like including differences in context, stereos, and coping mechanism. In the work environment, individual can feel compelled sometimes to exhibit professionalism, effective communication, and conflict resolution skills, leading them to prioritize the emotional intelligence behavior. However, in personal settings, individual might encounter different dynamics, such as family conflict, personal insecurities, or unresolved emotional issues, which can challenge their ability to apply EI effectively. Additionally, external, or you can say personal circumstances, external or personal circumstances may impact one's emotional regulations and interpersonal interaction outside of work. Next, we have a book to improve emotional intelligence. Okay, so you can say Emotional Intelligence 2.0 by Travis. Then The EQ Edge, Emotional Intelligence and Your Success. That is by Stephen J. Steen and Howard ebook. Then there is one more, that is Primal Leadership, Realizing the Power of Emotional Intelligence by Daniel. I will write it in the chat box after I discuss all these questions. So next question is that, let me just check, just allow me a moment, what we have next. Is the person temperament a major factor of leadership quality? Okay. Temperament and leadership quality. See, an individual temperament can indeed influence their leadership style and effectiveness to some extent, which refers to the temperament refers to innate personality trait that shape an individual's natural tendency, preferences, and behavior patterns. While it alone may not determine leadership quality, it can impact how individual approach decision making, how individual approach the communication and interpersonal relationship in leadership role. Like for instance, leaders with extroverted and assertive temperaments may excel in roles that require charisma, that require initiative and assertiveness, while those with introverted and reflective temperaments might demonstrate strength in listening, strength strategy thinking, or relationship building. So effective leadership often involves all the leverages one's temperament strength, while also developing complementary skills such as, you can, emotional intelligence, adaptability, or communication to meet the demand of diverse situations. Okay, next question what we have is, what is the pivotal role of emotional intelligence? What are the role of emotional intelligence enhancing interpersonal relationship, effective leadership, decision making, stress management? AI skills such as self-awareness, emotional regulation, help individuals cope with stressors and maintain the well-being. It helps individuals to consider emotional long-side rationality when make decisions, leading to more thoughtful and well-rounded choice. Leaders with high AI can inspire the trust, navigate conflict, and motivate team driving organizational success. So overall, emotional intelligence is instrumental in promoting individual resilience, social competencies, and overall success in a various sphere of life. Any book for improve? I guess we already have discussed this EQ question for the books. Okay, let's jump to the next question. Just allow me a moment, everyone. Thank you so much for your participation. How can AI help build emotional intelligence in an organization? See, how can AI do that? Leaders with the extroverted and assertiveness. In this, AI excels the role that require all the initiative and all the assertiveness in this. AI-powered tools can analyze facial expression, tone of voice, and other non-verbal cues to accurately detect and interpret emotions. By integrating such technology into communication platform or feedback system, organization can gain insights into the emotional states of employee during interaction or during meeting. That is known as emotion recognition technology. Then you can say feedback and performance evaluation AI can do, personalized learning and development AI can do, virtual reality VR, which is known as simulation AI can do, then chatbots and virtual assistants, AI driven chatbots and virtual assistants equipped with natural language processing capabilities can provide on demand support and guidance to employees on emotional intelligence related topics. You can say it means whether it's offering advice on managing stress or resolving conflict and improving your communication, AI can definitely help, and it's immediate assistance. You can see then AI driven sentiments analysis tools which can analyze written feedback, performance review, or employer survey why to identify patterns and trend related to the emotional intelligence. So if we leverage all these technologies in these ways, organization can create supportive ecosystem that promotes the development of emotional intelligence among employees, ultimately leading to improved collaboration, leading to improve the well-being and organizational success. However, it is essential to ensure that the AI application are ethically designed. It should be transparent and aligned with the organizational success, and by maximizing their effectiveness and minimize the potential biases or any kind of risk. Okay, we have one more question over here. The first one is there any books to improve IQ? And the second is, what is the role of leaders in an organization? There are numerous books available to improve the abilities and enhance the intellectual quotient. That is Think Fast and Slow by Daniel. How to Think Like Sherlock. Then Mastermind Everyday Life. Then Mindset by The New Philosophy of Success by Carol. So these two, three books I know, and the one more, that is The Art of Thinking Clearly by Royce. So yes, these books can definitely help. Second is the role regarding the leadership in organization. Vision and strategy, decision making, inspiration and motivation role, team building and development role, change management. In this, leaders navigate organizational change effectively, guiding employees through transition, overcoming resistance and fostering culture of ability and resilience. Then at last, stakeholder management. In this, leaders engage with internal and external stakeholders, which include, you can say, employee, customers, inventors, then investors, community members, and building relationship partnership that contribute to organization success. So yes, these are the roles. Okay, so please share the PPT here itself and not separately. Unfortunately, we cannot share the PPT here or on email. but you can get the recordings. What are the recommended ways to do self-assessment of emotional intelligence? Set aside time regularly to reflect on your emotions, reactions, and interactions with others. You can say it reflective journaling, means write down specific situation where you experienced different emotions and consider how you recommended, what triggered through emotions and the outcome of your reaction. Then second is self-assessment questionnaire we can prepare. Means there are several validate self-assessment questionnaire and survey designed to measure different aspects of EI. And these questionnaires typically ask individuals to rate themselves on various EI competencies, such as self-awareness, self-regulation, empathy, social skills, motivations. Examples we have including the emotional intelligence appraisal, EIA, which is known as by Travis Bradbury, and EQ, I 2.0 assessment we have. Yeah, means compiling all these questionnaires can provide a structure framework for you for evaluating the your emotional intelligence ability and identify the area for the development. Then we have 360 degree feedback. Now, what is this? We seek feedback from colleagues, friends, and family members or mentor on emotional intelligence skills. We can and ask for honest observation and insight into how you manage emotions, communicate with others, handle conflicts, and build relationships. Now, we will compare their feedback with your own self-perception of yours, that how you have done, to gain a understanding of your EI strength and blind spot. Then behavior assessment we can do, professional coaching or counseling. And if you engage in all these ongoing learning and development activities, then enhance your emotional intelligence. And if you attend a few workshops, seminars, or training program, which is focused on EI, particularly skills such as mindfulness, conflict resolution, you can practice implementing this skill in daily life and reflect on progress over time. It will definitely. Okay. Next question we have. What is the key for leadership and what is the difference between leadership in flat organization versus hierarchical organization, leadership roles, responsibility, etc.? The key leadership first question is key leadership, that is vision and purpose, integrity and trustworthiness, communication and collaboration, empathy and emotional intelligence, adaptability and resilience, empowerment and development. Then regarding the difference between leadership in flat organization versus hierarchical organization, first let's talk about flat organization roles and responsibility. In this, leadership role may be distributed more evenly across the organization with less emphasis on formal titles or hierarchies. So employees may have greater autonomy and decision-making authority in their respective area of expertise. Second point I would like to give over here, that is collaboration and communication. Leadership is characterized by a more collaborative and participative approach with an emphasis on open communication, teamwork, and team building. Second is hierarchical organization. First, the roles and responsibility in this. Leadership roles are typically defined by formal titles and reporting structure, means with clear lines of authority and decision making. Leaders at different level have distinct responsibility and area of accountability. Second, chain of command. Leadership follows a traditional chain of command where decisions flow from top management down through various levels of middle management to frontline employee. Top management to down management and the middle management to frontline employee. In this, leadership in hierarchical organization focus on setting the direction, establish policy and procedures, and exercising control over operations to achieve organizational objective. Like overall, while the fundamental principle of leadership remains constant across different organizational structures, the specific roles, responsibility we have discussed, communication, dynamic, decision-making process may vary based on whether the organization is flat or hierarchical. Okay, are you able to share the recording and you said PPT, please? I'm really, very sorry, but we cannot share the PPTs, but we can share you the recording at the end of the session. Okay, so let's go ahead with the next question. How do you recognize and manage your own emotion in challenging situation? By the process of self-awareness, like I need to cultivate self-awareness by paying attention to my own thoughts, my own feelings and physical sensations. You notice when you start to experience strong emotions, right? You need to react. So that you need to understand your own emotions. And it's better to respond and it's better to be quiet at some point of time rather than react and responding all the time. Practicing mindfulness techniques, deep breathing, meditation, or body scan means to anchor yourself in the present moment and observe your emotions. Labeling your emotions can help you gain clarity. And you need to have clear perspective with this. Instead of simply feeling overwhelmed, try to name the specific emotions you're experiencing. For example, are you frustrated? Are you feeling anxiety, angry, happy, shocked? They can make the emotion feel more manageable. And when faced with a challenging situation, take a moment to pause before reacting impulsively. Use this time to reflect on your emotions and consider the potential consequences of your actions. And choose a thoughtful response rather than a reactive one. So this is how we do. Anyone else?
Just small announcement from my side. Yeah, if anybody wants to continue for the enrollment of the course or want to have any training with us, I'll be sharing my details on the chat box. Kindly mail me with all the required details so that our expert will get back to you with all the required details as well. And kindly fill the attendance sheet for the webinar certificates. And yes, you will receive the recordings after 48 hours of the completion on our official website, which I've shared in the chat as well. Thank you, Kansha. Over to you for the Q&As.
Thank you so much. The next question is, can you give me more detail about the referent power? Referent power is one of the five bases of power identified by social psychologists. That is, the name of the person is John French. And in their seminal work on power, social influence means it refers to the ability of person who can influence others based on their administration or respect or identification with that individual. So different power is derived from the personal qualities, personal trait or attribute of the individual that other admires, respect or aspire to emulate. These qualities may include expertise, their charisma and their personality, authenticity, likability and perceived similarity to others. Referent power can also stem from shared value, belief, or interest between the influencer and the target. So individual who possess the referent power can exert significant influence over others' attitude, opinion, and behavior. People may voluntarily comply with the influencer request, seek approval, or validate from other, or you can say relevant in others' perspective, inspire loyalty and commitment. So while referent power can be a potent tool for influence, it is not without limitation. Its effectiveness may vary depending on factors as the perceived credibility or authenticity of the influence. So referent power is a form of social influence based on the administration and respect or identification that others have with an individual. And it plays important role in leadership, in persuasiveness, and social dynamic, because it will highlight the importance of your personal qualities and relationship in influencing others' attitude and the behavior. Anyone else? Any question? Any question you have, I'll definitely answer. Okay, so we have question at the top. I'm really, really sorry. I didn't scroll up. Is this news reading? And self-PPT will read ourselves. All right, no worries. If you have any question regarding any slide or any question regarding the topic which I have discussed with you, you can ask me any question and I will definitely answer that with example. If you have any kind of doubt, if you feel like it is a news reading, I will definitely answer it, sir. Okay, so we have a question over here. How do you approach giving and receiving constructive feedback in a way that promotes mutual understanding and growth? Create a supportive and non-judgmental environment first, where individual feels comfortable, right? Sharing feedback openly and honestly. Emphasize trust, respect, and confidentiality to build psychological safety is very important. Now, you will allow for constructive dialogue and learning, right? So when giving feedback, focus on specific behaviors or actions rather than making judgment about the individual's character or personality. Now, use objective observation and concrete examples to illustrate your points, avoiding generalizing or assumption. Then when you structure the feedback using feedback sandwich method, we can do this, right? Which involves a sandwiching constructive criticism between positive feedback and encouragement. So start with acknowledging strength or area of improvement. Means provide specific feedback on areas for development and conclude with words of encouragement and support others. Because if you support others, definitely others will support you. People will support you. Provide feedback that is specific, that is actionable and relevant to the individual's goals and responsibility. Avoid vague and ambiguous feedback. Instead, offer practical suggestions or recommendation for improvement that the recipient can implement easily. And by approaching all these means, by approaching the giving and receiving of constructive feedback with empathy, with respect, and shared commitment to growth and development, individual can foster mutual understanding. And in this, people management is very important. Way of talking is very important. Politeness is very important. Using please is very important. Thank you is very important. So that you can build the strength in the relationship and facilitate meaningful progress towards personal and organizational goals. Thank you so much for the question. I'll definitely reply your question, sir. Just allow me a moment. And we have the question is leadership models, especially trait model. Okay. Certainly, the trait model of leadership is one of the earliest theory of leadership, which proposing that certain innate traits or characteristics distinguish effective leaders for non-leadership. So the trait model of leadership suggests that certain personal qualities or characteristics are inherent to effective leadership. And these traits are believed to be relatively stable over time and across different situations distinguish leaders from non-leaders. An early research on the trait model focused on identifying specific traits associated with effective leadership. And some common traits identified include intelligence, self-confidence, integrity, social ability, emotional stability, assertiveness, and drive for achievement. So while the trait model of leadership focused on identifying specific trait associates, what they do, while the trait model of leadership laid the groundwork for understanding the leadership, it has several limitations. We will talk about the limitations too, because we have talked about the basic premise, then the key traits, then the limitation. Why? Because critics argue that the model oversimplified leadership by focusing solely on individual characters and neglecting the situational factors, neglecting the followership, dynamic and complex interaction between leaders and their environment. Additionally, researcher findings on research finds on trait-based predictors of leadership effectiveness can be inconsistent by suggesting that trait alone may not fully account for leadership effectiveness. So overall, while the trait model of leadership laid a foundation for understanding leadership, contemporary perspective recognition that effective leadership involves a combination of trait, behavior, skill, and contextual factors. So leaders may possess certain trait associated with the effectiveness. Means in trait-based leadership assessment, basically, despite these limitations, trait-based has influenced the development of leadership assessment, the tools and the techniques. And there are various instruments such as personality assessment, leadership survey, and competencies model, which have been used to evaluate individual leadership potential based on the trait-based criteria. Anyone, do you have any question? Anyone else? We have 5 minutes left with us. If you're confused and not able to understand anything, you can ask me again. I will definitely answer that. Okay, I'll keep in mind that you said when you answer the question, please speak slowly. Thank you so much. All right, I'll keep in mind, sir. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Anything? Any question? You will get the recording after the session. After 48 hours, like within 48 hours, you will get the recordings. Thank you so much, everyone, for your presence, for your questions. I appreciate your time and patience.